Bien, quelle meilleure transition que cette...
Okay, well, this demo is the best transition because it demonstrates creativity. So let's have a round table on creativity at the heart of the internet ecosystem. Over to Philippe Collin. Philippe Collin, as I said, is responsible for support to innovation. And within OB3FD, he is in permanent contact with entrepreneurs. So Philippe, over to you. Thank you, and I'd like to ask the participant to this roundtable to join me on stage. Please, Marianne, Étienne, and Cyril. So we've got mics, we've got everything we need.
Hello.
So for housekeeping details, first, thank you for giving us the floor. We have a fourth participant to this roundtable, that's Scott Smith. Scott Smith will join us via Skype from Canada, and he will be speaking English. So for those of you who would be interested, we have headsets for you to be able and follow on what Scott is going to say. And for those of you who speak English in the room, feel free to take your headset. Hi, Scott.
Hello. Excellent.
Okay, thank you. You can hear us. So, the topic of our roundtable is new technology in a creative environment. We spent the entire afternoon demonstrating this new technology and revealing a bit more about the Frogans technology with FSDL. But of course, there is an additional step, and that's taking ownership of this technology, for this technology to no longer be in the hands of developers, and through the power of developers, people who dream about various experience, online experience, to make it their technology. So, I'm going to introduce the people who will be joining us today, and then we can start our debates. Marianne Feignier, good evening. Marianne is a webmaster. She's also a web designer. She has created many different sites. And by the way, this is her second career, because in the past, she was a comedian. She was an actress. So she has a different vision over the world of online publishing. And she will be telling us about her experience this afternoon, because she was sitting with us as a beta tester. So we'll see if she'd like to say a few words about her experience. And then she'll tell us about the conditions for her to take this new technology on board in her new career as a web designer. Cyril Rimbaud, good evening. Cyril, you wear many hats, if I'm not mistaken. So we've seen your first hat, because you're one of the guys who developed a Frogans slide. Even two, so you had too much time, in fact. So he designed the Cat Bear site, but also the one with the picture. And I developed a webzine called The Bears in 1995. So that's my bear. So that's the bear keeps popping up in Cyril's career. Cyril is also a teacher at the Image Academy at Gobelin, and he's working on connected objects. And you're also a contributor to CureUser, which is a firm that provides advice in digital technology. Yes, we are CureUser, and we are a small firm, and we help large companies understanding what these strange things are about, you know, internet, connected objects, all these things made for developers, and they have nothing to do in a company when you're not a network engineer. when there are many things that can be done with these technologies to help companies create new services, new business models, and make sure that these companies go through the 21st century without collapsing. So Curiosa, are you mostly technicians? Well, we wear many hats. We all come from the web. And we think users first, and then we realize that when you think users, technology comes second, and then all it takes is to have the appropriate skills. But we need people with a good technological background, because otherwise it's no use. When you can do both, you can do everything. So all you need to learn is to encode. Thank you, that's very kind. Is it because of my bear that didn't look like a cat? Étienne Landel, for those of you who took part in the previous conferences, we know you already because you're the co-founder of the Aester initiative, which created one of the sites that you just saw, the one with the golf course, and you are a professor at Celsa in Paris University, and you're responsible for one specific master's degree. Yes, computer media and communication strategy. So I'm training, educating future communication managers, experts in new technologies, people who will look at the relationship between communication and IT. And when you have a bit of free time, Étienne, you work on short formats. And with Frogans, we are in the world of short format. So you write short poems on Twitter. Yes, that's a third part of my personality. Of course, it's probably less involved in Frogan's development, but I have a specific interest around format issues and what makes communication possible through limited formats. And Frogan's is very interesting from that angle. I think I have this appetite for small things. And if you want to follow me on you can follow me on Etienne_Candel. And the other one is Etienne_CDL, but that's totally different. I'm slightly schizophrenic. And then you want to follow Aester_FR, which is the Twitter account for the Aester initiative. Okay. We will make these contact details available on live our from, website. And then live from Ontario, Canada.
Hi, Scott.
Scott Smith. Hi, Scott.
Bonjour.
Okay. Scott is an internet entrepreneur looking to exploit future trends, if I understand correctly, especially around naming. And as such, you're the CEO of a company called RokMe Incorporated, who owns a service called UbiNames. You want to tell us a few words about UbiNames?
Yeah, so first of all, thank you for having me. And my apologies for the bad lighting here at my home studio. UbiNames was created about a year ago, specifically to assist people to connect wirelessly. And I think we're getting some feedback here, so hopefully this is going to come out properly. UbiNames, essentially what it does, it allows people to create a profile from a wireless name, much like a URL. Can represent a website. A UbiNames can represent a wireless, essentially a wireless website or a wireless identity for you. And it allows you to create a profile and to share information that you elect to share with other people in your proximity.
There's a direct relationship. Direct relationship with the Frogans technology, because you started thinking about potential usage of Frogans with UbiNames. You want to talk about that a little more?
Right. I first learned of Frogans from a domain conference back in January 2015, NamesCon, where I met Colin Philippe and his partners, and got very excited about the potential for the technology, realizing that UbiNames and the wireless proximal identity technology that we were undertaking at the time, that there may be some parallels. So I, you know, kept in contact with Philippe and understood a little bit more as we went, and became one of the first four people to become a Frogans account holder. I think even in front of people like Amazon. So we have been following the technology, and we have been following their growth and development, and always looking forward to the day when the browser and the ability to actually look at sites in the way you've demonstrated today, looking for them to come to the public view so we could actually start to build some sample sites and start to show people how these sites work. And again, trying to always look at the potential connection for UbiNames and the wireless side of the equation.
Okay, thank you. You mentioned maybe an idea of a usage of a Frogans site with UbiNames, for example, in the event marketing environment.
That's correct. One of the biggest challenges that event marketers have, and the people who create event apps, it's a very, very competitive market. One of the Achilles heel in all of those apps is the ability to network. And I'll give you a short example. I went to a startup fest, a startup organization in Montreal a few months back, and the networking consisted of getting your lanyard, your name tag, and if you wanted to speak to somebody about a particular interest you had, it was the same situation whereby you had to go look at the name tag. Hi, your name is Bill. My name is Scott. What do you do? Et cetera. So you may invest, you know, 5-10 minutes in idle chit chat before you're able to get down to, you know, the real reasons why you're attending that conference. So it struck me that if we were able to have a UbiNames profile through the event app, we would be able to say, for example, in my profile, I'm an entrepreneur, I'm looking for investment capital, so I'm looking for venture capitalists who are interested in companies with capitalization less than $500,000 or less than $5 million. The venture capitalist would say on his profile, I'm a venture capitalist, I'm looking for companies to invest in. And once once our profiles are created, once we came into proximity within the event, the notices on our phone would give us a signal and say, there are three or four venture capitalists in this immediate area, and they would be able to identify me. I would be able to identify them without even knowing who they are, strictly because our phones were in proximity and the profiles on our event app match. And that way we would think we can greatly enhance the user experience, provide more benefits for the event organizers as they add more value for their attendees, and more value to the attendees in that they don't waste an awful lot of time, you know, trying to read name tags and go through idle chit chat. They can get right to the point and start their networking. All right.
So if I'm correct, I'm attending an event. I have a profile online on my mobile device, and because I'm in the same room as someone who's matching my profile, then maybe a Frogans site will pop up on my phone or on my computer and explain that this person, Joe, is of interest. Is that something you're thinking about?
That's correct. So the individual could have in his profile perhaps his resume on a Frogans site. He might have a sample of his work, and it could be audio, could be video, text, or pictures, whatever that person wants to share with the other people that have a similar profile at that event. And it's not just, it could be within meters of where you're at, or it could be within tens or hundreds of meters. So it has wide-ranging applications.
All right. So this is, thank you for the idea here. This is a great example to start this conversation about what are the conditions that this new technology will be, the appropriation of this new technology for the users at this conference. Do you have any idea what would which conditions should be would have to be fulfilled to favorize the appropriation of the technology? And then I'll ask the same question to the other panelists here.
If you want me to continue. The thing is that we're both in very early stages. So as the technology, the Frogans technology is now being introduced to developers and the browsers are becoming available so that people can start to see what the site looks like and what have you, I think that's very, very exciting. Again, UbiNames is now just now is launching into the public marketed way as well. So I think that there is an awful lot of potential for many, many use cases, business cases, and I'm excited to be able to share this with the public so that we also can get feedback question about the technology and safety and security and all of the other benefits that it affords.
Excellent. So let me ask the same question to Étienne, back to French, and say that to the translators. Étienne, à votre avis, à ton avis, quelles sont les conditions?
Étienne, what are the conditions, the prerequisites for these new technologies to be adopted? And I'm thinking about not just Frogans, but also about UbiNames as presented by our friend. Well, conditions, I don't know, but one of the essential conditions is that it should stimulate a desire, a need. Like, we need people to have a desire to see how it works. Then, on the other hand, what is interesting with this type of presentation is that we see what happens when such a technology comes out. Some players would position themselves to start creating markets. And in fact, we encounter situations like providing phones to people during events so that they can access certain information. And then the big question is, what kind of players are we talking about? Who has an experience in the field? And to a certain extent, it's a whole business environment that needs to be developed, and all the prerequisites are quite numerous in that respect. Then there can be obstacles, which are fundamental elements for the Frogans technologies, like installing a browser, a player, and wondering how this installation can be as painless as possible. And this is going to be a true prerequisite, because once a digital world is equipped with Frogans addresses, and when people start reading the contents, there is a certain level of freedom. Everything's open for any possibility of creation. But with regards to these technical obstacles, and with regards to a world in which demand does not exist as yet, I mean, there is a question as to what's new? What does it bring? What does it offer? And we've not talked about the opposition between web and Frogans. We've talked a bit, Cyril and myself, and we agreed on one thing, which is important, i.e. we should not see the web as being where we come from. We all know the web, HTML, and it's people know the websites, but we need to realize that we are talking about something totally new, totally different, and it's a new world altogether. It's not just a new internet. It should be seen as a new step. It's probably more attractive, rather than saying with the web you had this, now you can have that. Okay, I'll stop now, and I give the floor to my colleagues.
Any thoughts? Absolutely. I was discussing with Etienne right before this. If you offer Frogans to marketing people or communication experts, in their mind, it's all internet. Everything is internet. And their first reaction would be, what is my return on investment? How does it compare to the web? That's marketing. If a communication expert, if you talk to a communication expert, they will say, well, wait a minute, how does it work? How does it communicate? I have my target audience and so on. Look at it as something new. Frogans is something completely different. So we need to look at the foundation of Frogans. What makes it unique? What distinguishes it? Well, and that's really how you can propagate this technology. So what makes it different? It's not the graphic design, you know. You know, you have flash technology for that. 20 years ago, I would have used Dreamweaver or, you know, I don't know if you remember this. This is a century ago. But anyway, it's not so much for creative work. What's interesting with Frogan is image integrity. The fact it's on any device. You get the same image across the board. That is huge. That is very powerful. Something that doesn't exist on the web. And this is something I think Frogans should communicate, because this could this is a great reason for brands to adopt Frogans. Image integrity, and this could generate all kinds of other things. You know, think about tickets, plane tickets, barcodes, same format, no matter what device you have. It can be very convincing. As a brand, all of a sudden you can start creating events that, you know, or all kinds of things run on Frogans. So that's how you, that's how I think you should look at it. Don't compare it to the web. If you compare yourself to the web, you're dead. I agree. I am. I have very little experience, and definitely, you're right. That would be my first question. How is it going to change my life? What makes it different from the web? You know, I mean, the truth is that on websites have become pretty comfortable, no matter what device you have. It's complicated when you're an operator, but for end users, it's pretty straight. It's pretty seamless, right? But what we have today on the web is 20 years of hard work. Back in 1995, I remember HTML3. These were the early days sites, you know, and there was not much we could do. You know, images were GIFs. You know, we were very technically limited back in 1995. 20 years later, what do we have? HTML5, CSS3, 4, 5, I can't remember. Java all over the place. Really exciting things, frameworks that are very simple to use, but it's 20 years after. So I guess we are a little bit like with Frogans, like the web was in 1995. Okay, so what you're saying is that we should focus really on what makes it different, what makes Frogans unique. Again, the fact you get the same site no matter what device you're on. Yeah, that's what I called integrity, says one of the panelists. The fact you can use it for specific applications, for example, ID documents. You get an, you know, authenticated source. For example, if the source needs to be authenticated, and taking it a step further, look at the future. Right now, you know, people are preparing the web of tomorrow with Internet of Things. Can you imagine Frogans with its little widgets and slides? Can you imagine if Frogans could read all this data? You know, and potentially even interface it with sensors, you know, to have a fully protected system. I would personally prefer to have that kind of technology rather than the web, because the web has so many loopholes, and you never know where your data ends up. So, if it's on a protected server with a safer technology than some of the standard web technology, I think as an end user, I'm going to feel more reassured, which could encourage me to use more technology, you know, be more open to technology. Right, so we've been talking about Frogans. So portability, security, how about the internationalization of addresses?
Well, Candel a été pas mal touché du doigt par l'OP3FT.
I think OP3FT has done a lot of work in that area already.
Une description du monde, mais aussi un jugement ou une idée de est-ce que c'est bien ou pas bien, par exemple.
I think Internet of Objects, Internet of Things, a lot of people see it as an opportunity, but a lot of people see it as a threat. So when you hear about security today, Internet of Objects is often referred to as, you know, is seen as an argument. Likewise, there is this willingness to internationalize codes, including linguistic codes for Frogans, for example, simply because the web or internet is mainly the internet of the Western world with big networks and more bandwidth, high speed access, devices being renewed every other year, and so on. So some of the questions is, okay, where do we stand? What's the status of the world today? What devices do people use? And what opportunities exist? Not to reach out to these audiences, but I think we need to completely... I think it's a question of behavior also. You know, some of the advertising blocking software have been very successful. For example, there is so much data that is traveling through our devices, whether we want it or not, and the networks are saturated with advertising. They've become more powerful. But if all of a sudden we had small objects that we own, not with huge volumes, huge amounts, I think for a lot of people, this is something that would resonate. Not just for technical reasons, but for societal reasons. I think it's a way to create value. I think it's important to communicate about the things that can promote. You don't have to be deterministic. You know, you don't. Claiming that it's safe is not going to push everybody to adopt it overnight simply because it is safe. But eventually, it can resonate. And you know, for people who are pushing technology and people who are interested in this technology and the ecosystem, I think it's important to say, okay, let's take a look at where we stand today in terms of security, updates, your victims, we're victims of updates. You know, as soon as we are connected, we have, you know, updates. For example, for some people, some people may consider that it's very normal for when you have a phone, as soon as your phone connects, to pick up automatically the updates in the cloud. But it may not be natural or normal for some people, you know. And then there is the security issue, piracy, or simply the fact that before you realize it, your battery is empty. Marianne? Any thoughts? What do you think does it take for people to adopt a new technology like this? We talked about some of the things to leverage. Can you think of any other things? How about the tools? Tools maybe to encourage or to help creativity. You mean site creation? Yes, for example. To create my sites, I use CMS, WordPress. So it was interesting to hear about this new language. It seems, from what I saw, to be very accessible. I attended this afternoon session, and I got the impression that it's quite rapid. Will it really save time? That's what it comes down to for me. You know, with CMS, I can work extremely quickly. I have multiple tools. So does Frogans want to move on, or does it simply want to do codes and nothing more than codes? Well, that's a good question. Since I have the floor, let me answer that question. I think the role of OP3FT is to make a standard and a language available. We've had a demo this afternoon of the language. But in the Frogans ecosystem, some people will take the lead to develop things like WordPress, CMS, tools that were based on easy interfaces like WYSIWYG, for example, where you can manipulate objects rather than codes, and this is going to make publishing a lot more intuitive, a lot easier, much more straightforward, and you can get immediate results. You can look at the results immediately, and then in a very incremental way, you can enrich the site. So the creative process is going to be a lot simpler. Today was the first demo. It was the very first conference where we introduced FSDL. So we really took a dive into the heart of this language. But before we come up with a library, a software library, we're going to develop a lot more things. And hopefully developers will use it. But today we really wanted to show the detail of the programming. We think that very few people are going to do what we saw this afternoon, are going to create sites using Frogans language like we saw this afternoon. Okay, but today, with CMS, there are a lot of constraints. Do you think that with a tool like Frogans, with FSDL, things could change? It could be easier? Well, OP3FT can't really answer that question. Our role is to make things as simple as possible to third parties. People who are going to develop tools in the ecosystem need simplicity. And we want them to be used to use bits and pieces of codes to make their lives easier, or make the life of creative people easier. So they need to decide what tools they want to use, what interface, what colors, and so on. We've had a lot of questions about the availability of software libraries, these little bits and pieces of programs that are used almost like a small engine. In order to make the life of designers easier. But I do not want to answer for them, but in a nutshell, my answer is yes, there will be more simplicity. I think CMS is interesting because I think you have to make the connection between a technology and its audience. When you have standard formats that you can customize, that you can reuse, this is typically something the media like. Blogs existed before blog CMSs, but it's really when big blog platforms arrived, that all of a sudden blogging became very exciting. That was less than 10 years ago. Yeah, for 10 years there was no CMS. There were frameworks out there. I don't know if you remember, but there were these tools sometimes that you could use to use websites. I remember Microsoft did one. It was disgusting. It was horrible. Absolutely horrible. Front page. That was, oh my God, it was bad. It was really bad. It took forever, And we did this with text editing. And then CMS arrives, and all of a sudden everybody, was able to create and, create websites or pieces of websites. Before that, it was really only developers who could develop. So things, initially was very highly professionalized. We had web designers who did a little bit of creative work, and then we had developers on one side, creative people on the other side, and they would agree together on what color and so on. And little by little, it changed. And today, everybody can create a website. Yes.
assez uniforme puisque mettons que tout le monde utilise.
But let's imagine if everybody starts using the same model with the same flaws. As you said, there were a lot of very mediocre websites. But again, that's before some platforms, you know, were developed and all of a sudden changed things.
C'est là où ce qui est intéressant, c'est qu'il ne faut pas réinventer l'Internet.
What's interesting is that we're not here to reinvent the web. We need to keep that in mind. We can't. We need to find things that make Frogans unique. With the web, we've lost certain things. You know, if you had a think about the CD-ROM. Transparency is gone with the web. I remember these transparent pop-ups. This was back in 1998. There were commercials. They were transparent. And I remember playing with these, and then they were discontinued. You know, there were GIFs with 156 colors. It was pretty ugly. We've lost this with the web. Here, now it's back. With transparency, you can do a lot. Think about all the creative work, all the creative things you can do with transparency, by putting Frogans on top of each other, by assembling them, by creating systems. There, you know, it's really all about being creative. And I really think there are great opportunities, and that's very unique to same thing for opacacity. That's not something you can do with a web page. Your browser is not transparent. Your page is white. So, you know, we have to really think out of the box. Okay, well, that's interesting. And we have you've obviously been some hard thinking. Well, that's my job. Okay, let's turn to Scott.
Can I ask you if you have any ideas how to help the diffusion of a technology like the Frogans technology? I mean, beyond the usage you shared with us earlier.
Yes, there's been a long time between the conversations, so again, I'm not quite sure if we're in sync or not. A couple of points that were made earlier with regards to the Internet of Things and the importance of the Internet of Things and how we are being more connected through smart homes, smart cars, smart devices, etc. And the UbiNames plays a very, very important part in that ecosystem. So imagine for a moment you have a profile, this UbiNames profile, and in that profile you can have any number of interests that you share, and those interests can lead to, like I said, it could lead to a Frogans site, it could lead to a LinkedIn page, it could lead to pictures, text, video, etc. All of those are possible. But when you start to think about what the underlying technology really is, we're about proximity and detection. So anytime that you have a device or devices that are within close proximity of each other, they talk to each other. And as you create your profile, your UbiNames profile, it travels with you. So I may have started a profile to go to a startup festival in Montreal, but that same profile, I have the ability to add on and create other profiles. So let's say, for example, at that Montreal startup festival, there's a venture capitalist. And in his venture capitalist profile, he has, I want to meet companies, small startup companies, and other parts. But and he turns that on, and during the course of the conference, he runs into people who are looking for venture capital. That's great, they connect. After the event has finished, and now the venture capitalist is perhaps going down into a nice part of town and going out to nightclubs and dinner, well, he might not want the venture capital part of his profile available. So he has the ability to turn that off. And he may go to a dating profile or some other profile. So the key thing being here is that these devices are all talking to each other. And when you create that profile, you are also able to associate content with many devices. So your profile, you can have a home router. You can put up, you can incorporate the refrigerator, your microwave, your car, your Nest, your smart home devices can all be attributed content within your profile, and you're able to control that. And this is really, really important because right now there's an awful lot of these signals that get transferred between devices, and they are, for lack of a better word, unmanaged. With a UbiNames profile, you are now able to manage that content, manage access to that content, and provide a much greater degree of security and privacy.
Okay.
So again, that's a very, very important part. And as Frogans addresses and Frogans sites become more and more prevalent, and there are connections with systems like UbiNames, we think that we're able to create a much more robust, a much more stable, secure profiles in this wireless world in the Internet of Things.
Sure.
Again, there's a lot of things happening in the background. Some of the challenges that we as companies, Frogans and UbiNames, this becomes an issue of marketing and acceptance and how quickly we can get to market.
Right.
We have to be able to share this information transparently, openly, with the crowds, allowing them to take it and run with it on their own, to create new opportunities that we don't see. Again, even today in the examples of building the Frogans websites, there are multiple of ways that people envision using these services. We believe that's the same with UbiNames, whereby you'll be able to find a lot of different uses for that and to create those profiles and create value within the wireless world.
Okay, thank you. In this case, the other panelists here, when we're asked about, maybe you missed that, but the ways to increase acceptance of a new technology, they named the way the technology was positioned, the way it was pitched, and maybe also the tools they were gathering, they were built around the new technology. In the case of UbiNames and this wireless registry, what are the different actions that you guys lead to increase acceptance of the technology in the market you're targeting?
That's a great question, and it's something that we've grappled with right from the very beginning. As you know, any new technology that has some complexity in the background, some complexity in the technology, where this is certainly the case, does take time. And you know, from the time that we met last year at NamesCon, and I got excited about the Frogans program, and we've been working with the providers of technology, the wireless registry, the company that actually owns the patents and the underlying technology that allows UbiNames to do what it does. It's been a real roller coaster because there are so many potential use cases and potential business cases. So we see the opportunity to, for example, in retail. Many retailers are using beacons so that a beacon will, send out signals. I'm not sure if we got cut off, but anyway, if we're still hearing, beacon technology can send out signals, and your UbiName can pick it up, and you can manage and control what you want to receive on those. So there are applications within government, within municipalities, within retail, within pharmaceutical, original OEMs. There are so many opportunities that it's difficult to focus on any one.
Right.
So what we did is that we selected a vertical market, and in this case, event managers and event management applications specifically, because there's some common characteristics that that's around that. So people are gathering for a particular event. People are going for a common interest. So whether it be a Formula One race, it could be a dragon boat race, it could be a concert, it could be a rodeo, whatever it is, major sporting event. People are gathering because they have they share interests. And if they all have their UbiNames and they have their interests detailed, then those people in your area that share your interests, you can connect with immediately. You recognize them, you can instant message them, you can text, whatever you want to do, and you're able to share that that experience with those people of like mind. So it's a real challenge, and one we're looking forward to, and hopefully by working with some of the Frogans and some of the Frogans early adopters, we would encourage you to reach out and to learn more about UbiNames. and to help us create those use cases that will benefit you and your audience.
Sure, thank you. Do you, I mean, just to be practical, do you try to develop the killer app using your technology? Do you try to develop use cases or on paper or in like business models for the users of your technology? What practically do you do to favorize the appropriation of the technology by your users?
Yeah, great question. And something, again, that's really been a challenge for us because there are so many applications. So we're in the midst of right now working with a couple of companies whereby they're going to take the underlying technology and develop apps specifically for their use case. So we could not possibly be in a position to write apps specifically for the automotive industry, the pharmaceutical, the retail, the entertainment industry, et cetera. There's just such a broad section of applications that are specific to those niche audiences. So we're looking at it more from a perspective of trying to provide the tools that will allow those organizations and those companies and those individual business cases to incorporate our technology and make their overall user experience as good as it can be. But the killer app, that's in the works in the background, to be determined at probably Frogans 7, 8, 9, or 10.
Okay, excellent. Là, on parle de l'application, ce qu'on appelle le killer app.
So we were talking about a killer app. Maybe you would have an idea, or maybe you have thoughts as to the necessity of having such a killer app. Well, when Frogans moves to the dynamic stage and is capable of including dynamic data in the small sites, well, that's going to be the perfect time in order to demonstrate the power of these Frogans. And, well, as for us, Etienne and myself, we work a lot with marketing and communication, and we know that journalists like it when it's kind of crunchy. And a killer app would symbolize all the potential of Frogans. So having this idea for a killer app, I mean, which killer app? What could it be? I don't know. But it should include all the specificities of Frogans without trying to imitate the web, because otherwise they will obviously compare it to internet and the internet they know, that is YouTube or Facebook. So we need to find an app that would demonstrate these specificities, integrity of data, of the image. Another aspect that we've not talked about, when you publish your Frogans, when you turn off your server, there is no Frogans. And that's very interesting because that's the genuine idea of the internet at the beginning. The websites were on the server. When you turn off the server, there is no website. But now you turn off your computer, your content stays online. Back in the days, this was not the case. So we are back to this, and there are things that we can develop. In terms of events and people meeting on events, integrity is very important for anyone who would publish content on Frogans, and they have control over it, and they can decide and suppress a site. The site is not archived, filed, backed up, saved somewhere. So that gives a great power. Would it be Frogans for politicians? Well, why not? That would avoid making public a certain number of blunders. But the fact that they can't be found is not a defect. In certain situations, for something which is linked to a specific event, which is valid for just a short period of time, that's an opportunity that can be developed in marketing. Something exists for a short period of time and stops existing without having to use a DRM system or authorization systems that can last for a while. So if the content no longer exists, it no longer exists. That's interesting. Another idea that we've not talked about, maybe you've talked about it amongst you, but is Frogans for B2B or B2C? I'm just a web surfer, which I was when I was a student. I had access to internet through my university. We have an internet club. It was CompuServe back in the days. I had to pay a small fee, but we were using the telephone. Everyone could go there. Even Frogans having a site is costly. It's going to be complex. So what's going to be the policy in that respect? Do we authorize advertising or not? In the beginning, Frogans were initiatives to fight against advertising that was arriving on the web and that was going to destroy everything. And we wanted to save our space for freedom. So that's interesting. What will happen with Frogans? Should we say Frogans is for B2B, it's for brands, companies, and too bad for guys, for the everyday guy? Or will Frogans be available to just any guy on the street? I'd like to answer. No, I'm here as a moderator. But Frogans is mostly, and in essence, is there to place the power back in the hand of everybody. Big corporations, small companies, private individuals, governments, Snowden, if he wants to, everyone, WikiLeaks, all these guys, Julian Assange, they all have access to an open source technology which they can use to publish sites that would be available to everyone. That's the promise of Frogans, but also to publish services, for these services to be used by others to publish their own sites. So in the case you were talking about, I could create a hosting service for Frogans sites so that any individual, when they don't have the ability or technical knowledge, well, they can publish their own sites in two clicks. So it creates a value chain which will allow some to publish, others to help people to publish, etc., etc. Okay, but you ask Snowden or Assange to design their own small app and create their domain name, Snowden star Frogans, people will identify Frogans as being a space of freedom which is not controlled by lobbies, by states, by major brands. But that takes a bit of guts, but why not? So that's an idea of a killer app. But to answer your question, it's B2B, B2C, B2B, B2B2C, B2C2B, and maybe a major player on the internet, because the technologies for hosting are similar to those for websites. So it's going to be not more expensive, not less expensive. It's going to be the same thing. A Frogan site is a set of files. They're stored in a tree, and this tree can be on any server, and the technologies that run these servers are similar, exactly the same as those used for the web. In the future, in the Frogans technology, we are thinking of using different protocols, different communication modes as compared to those used by the web at the moment. So we could imagine servers, Frogan servers, that would be different. So we could escape the current technical environment, but that's for another generation of killer apps. I'd like to answer, because I have not had time to answer your question. You were asking about the overall societal benefit of this technology. How can this technology benefit to society at large? Well, OP3FT was primarily created based on ethical standards with a certain number of principles, but I'm not a speaker for OP3FT, so I was sort of expecting you would say that. But over the last few years, with the priority registration periods for companies, brand holders, before developers could sign up, and then the public at large can sign up, we are moving towards less and less costly models. And if I want to protect the name of a brand, I can't do that because they had priority. And now that I can do that, I am going to register at a costly price. But when I just have to register my name, it's not going to be very costly. And producing a technology that's, it's quite easy to say it's easy because you need to have perfect control of the code, but there is an ambition to develop something that people can take ownership of and to develop a new age, a new era in publishing. But if we achieve easy to use, to develop easy to use technologies, if we manage to create clean, easy to use technologies, we could see a boom. And something which I think is important and interesting as well is what you were saying earlier with regards to our ability to think not just as something that's along the same line as the web, but we also need to think about the specificities of this technology. And this is going to be a competitive edge, because this is what will make this market, everyone included, this is what's going to make the difference. If we can think technology and think forward, and Frogans with Bluetooth, it's not the same way to manage communication because we're not on a centralized server, we're using a different tool, so it's more dynamic, it creates something, and that strategic thinking that will make the difference. And it's interesting to have this market, which is being structured through different initiatives, in which we'll see people emerging because they have more ideas and because they're more creative. So this is exactly my question. If Frogans stays in B2B, nothing will change because you'll just have people who will reproduce what they are used to with the traditional internet. So they will try and reproduce the traditional internet ideas using Frogans technology. Whereas if you open to B2C, to people who can do everything and anything, you'll get everything and anything, and this is how new startups, new business models can develop. Online trading classes, that's too easy. Remember, this is what appeared first on the web, with pages showing the stock prices and naked women on the site. So we'll get everything and absolutely everything and anything, and then it will start structuring itself. We'll see big startups, and that's where we can start thinking about FSDL4. So a killer app for you, Marianne, the key thing would be CMS, in my opinion, as a webmaster. That was my opinion. But the conference today opened my eyes far more than the previous ones, by the way. I learned many things. So my question now is, okay, I don't want to create a competition between Frogans and the web. And I need to realize that it's going to be a different use. So how can it come as an addition to the web? Because there must be bridges between the two. So it, you know, it leads to a large number of questions. There is one thing we've never talked about yet, which is digital identity. When you have a domain name that would expire when you turn off the machine, then you have a totally different relationship with what you're creating. And all this never worked in the past, but now maybe having this integrity, security. So it's also sad, by the way, because it means that we could have a digital ID card based on Frogans, and that would be horrible because the cops would have direct access to that. But there are things that we need to think about. Yes, one question to everyone, maybe. What would be the best way to think about this new usage, this killer app? Is it by talking directly to the ecosystem, by saying, OK, guys, here are some tools? How can we sow this seed, which is then going to grow for the benefit of everyone? Well, one simple thing, what worked very well with a cat, which turned into a bear, you promise a beer to every contributor and it works. It's always very great fun to take ownership of a new language. I've not looked at the hypertext links, but it's probably great fun. Imagine if we were staying there for one day with people who are used to do that, they have a challenge at the end. I'm quite certain many things would happen. But you'd have to push the machine with probably a local server, and it's always nice to start off with a brief. Okay, do whatever, not tell them do whatever you please. Starting with a defined user's need, and then start and work. Or talk about safety and integrity of data, or work on opacity. What can we do from a desktop when you have something transparent? Remember in the 80s, or no, it was back in 2003, there were these small apps that we had on our desktops. There were these girls, and they were walking on the at the bottom of your screen. Do you remember that? No, you can't? Okay, well, it was a big hit. We could imagine many different things, and that's based on the transparent aspect of the desktop. Or you had small characters that came to destroy your icons on your desktop. Well, there were a crowd, they were packed with malwares, but anyway, it was fun. I was so seduced by the hackathon and creativity. No, I don't know, but within the Aester project, our principle to approach the technology is to observe its specificities, what you call integrity or interoperability, the fact that you have perfect graphic integrity and an ability to create highly complex images, hence very beautiful images, so that's a great source of inspiration for us. And it goes along with the aesthetic dimension of the object that will be very important if we want it to be adopted by people. And other aspects like security, that's very important. For documents, your bills, your ID documents, etc. All this was part of our thinking process. Now, what kind of application should we develop? I don't know if we need to think about a killer app, something that's going to do everything, because a killer app was the app because it was used by millions of people. But maybe we want to start with very simple things, and maybe we can measure the benefit of Frogans' site, because they break away from the multifunctional apps. We want small tools that do not pretend to be a tool, that just pretend to be simple, rigorous, and lean sites. And we need to continue thinking about the aesthetics of these objects. How can we enhance the value of what is small as opposed to what is big? This is interesting because it creates a new relationship to the machine. Well, this was already done with the widgets. You know, Windows can't remember which, but you could display widgets on your screen. And we've seen loads of widgets for brands, etc. And it never led to anything. So why did it fail? Why don't we have any widgets on our desktops? Because apart from the post-it notes and your diary, there is none left. Why don't you have any other widget left on your desktop? That's interesting. Another question I'm asking to the audience, by the way, if they want to participate. Yes, if you do, raise your hand, grab a mic.
Okay. Alors peut-être pour conclure chacun.
Okay. In conclusion. So, to rephrase, we talked about killer apps, we talked about the hackathon, we talked about the aesthetics of the sites, we talked about security of the technology. And that's also true for UbiNames. Everything that encourages creativity when developing sites. Now, what can we say that will differentiate the Frogans technology from the other technologies out there? Should we change the words we use? Are you talking about OP3FT? No, but I understand the criticism made by Étienne because we use the word player. Yes, we had many discussions with the OP3FT on this topic, and we've had this discussion for a while, but the word player, in all the discussions I have with people who would adopt the technology, there is this idea that a player is a dangerous word. It has negative connotations.
Windows Media Player.
It makes us think about Flash Player, Windows Media Player. So, in any case, this word player is a bit of an issue. And the best would be for Frogans to be included in the operating system by default so that it would be opened very easily through a website. But there is a problem here. A browser, for instance, is probably not as scary as a player, but it is an issue to have this software tab and the word slide. It will probably be adopted by everyone. And the website is also a problem because this is a word that makes people think that we are rooted in the web. So now, without making an effort, but just talking about the objects, we talk about Frogans or a Frogan, and it works perfectly, and that's enough. Okay, I'd like to end this panel session with a survey, one question. And please, Scott, listen to this question. During the afternoon, you saw people, you saw a demo, a tutorial for encoding. In Frogans plan, there is this place where you access the menu and you have the yellow circle with the Frogans logo, which we call the...
Si vous aviez à utiliser un autre mot, si vous aviez envie, qu'est-ce qui vous viendrait à l'esprit?
Which we call the pastel or the an icon at the moment. But we call it a pastille. And what kind of other word would you use? Okay, you call it Frogans. It's not a confetti you have. It's a lily of the valley that you have. It's a big leaf of a lily of the valley. No, I think lily of the valley is too long. Click on the lily of the valley. That doesn't play well for me. No, I can't think of anything that comes to mind. No, it's a button, a confetti, or whatever. I don't know. Okay, I'll go around the room. So, confetti, I like it. It's small. It's circle. As long as the design remains what it is, I like it. But that's a very personal opinion, and it's not an issue for me to have this thing that's slightly rounded that looks a bit like a... and I don't know why. Maybe it's a nice word.
Le public, qu'est-ce que vous en pensez?
What would you think, you in the audience? A water lily. Come on, raise your hand. If you have any ideas, we're here to talk about creativity, by the way, so feel free to demonstrate your creativity.
I'm going to ask the same question to Scott as a conclusion. Scott, we show this afternoon the version of Frogans Player, the alpha version, on desktop. We used a Windows machine, and you access the menu of Frogans through... maybe you saw it, maybe you're online, of a yellow circle that we call the pastille, which is a French name. It's actually, it exists in English too. If you saw that menu, were you shocked by the name pastille, and did any other name come to mind when you saw that?
Well, I'm still a little bit behind in the conversation, so pardon me. I did see a little bit of the demonstration on the site that was built, and did see the pati, but didn't really have sort of negative connotations at the time. But in terms of something universal and acceptable to all, I think it can be a very, very challenge for you. One of the things that I heard earlier as I was listening to the conversation, and it was with regarding to uptake and who's going to, what groups or constituencies are going to use Frogans players, how are they going to be adopted, and what have you. And I think as we sit around the table, it is very easy for us to try and picture a perfect world in where these technologies and how they're going to be picked up and developed and used. But I also think that we're creatures of habit, and I think that we shouldn't be so naive as to not expect, at least to start, to follow some of the historical patterns that these technologies have taken up. So typically what happens is the leaders, unfortunately, are in the porn business. They put the money, they put the time, they put the resources into these technologies and explode, help to explode the ecosystem. But you're also going to have, those people that are outliers. You're going to have, the young kids that are now just, that want to rebel and try something different. So I think that you'll have a lot of different people coming at this from a lot of different angles. And to try and put a thumb in the air or guesstimate, which one is going to be better, which one is going to be faster, or what have you, is a fool's game. It's very difficult to predict. I think the best that we can do is to put it out there, and again, as Frogans has been, and as UbiNames and the underlying technology has been, is just be as transparent as you can, open it up to as many people as you can. There are so many factions and so many interest groups, and we have no way of knowing who's going to pick up the baton and run with it. So I think the best we can do is just say, you know, follow our guiding set of principles and transparency and security and privacy and you know, security of data, all of those sort of motherhood things that need to be endemic in a system for people to trust it, and then just throw it to the world. Let them go. Let them have some fun with it. Let them try. Let them make mistakes. The use cases will turn into business cases. And I suspect you'll see that there's going to be some parallel type of growth between the Frogans technology and the UbiNames only because of the newness of it and, you know, the applications that it serves. So I don't know if that answers the question or not, but get you back to Patti. Well, I have no idea. I don't have a number. In Canada, we'd probably say, call it a hockey puck.
Hockey pot. Okay, great. Well, thank you. You did answer the question, and at the same time, it's a great conclusion for this roundtable. Give the ecosystem a word on everything. Be as transparent as possible. Je voudrais remercier les panélistes ici à Paris.
I'd like to thank our panelists here in Paris. I'd like to thank you, Scott, for taking part in our roundtable on the take-up of this technology. And for our future events, whether FTC or other events, you're welcome to join us to continue sharing on these topics. I'm in charge of supporting innovation at OP3FT, and we innovate as much as we can, but it's also the responsibility of the ecosystem to create new usages and experience. Thank you.